Good day, students. My name is Dr. Mary Ann. So, in the last lecture, I talked about the procyonocytosis, anisocytosis, and anisochromia. So, let's continue. So, then what are the, so I think I've explained this, yes, anisocytosis. What else should you know for CROC? Then you also, we should talk about erythrocytosis. So, erythrocytosis is the increase in the number of what? Red blood cells. So it can be due to its the classification primary, so hereditary. Second, you can divide into absolute or relative. So this Vanket disease is known as true polycythemia. It is a what? This is when you have increase in red blood cell platelet and what? Leukocyte. So everything, just think about everything what increases. And this is disease is known as what? True polycythemia. But what is CROC going to ask you? Well, let's start. So the different types of anemia, how to differentiate it, yes. So what can cause anemia? So we have three causes. They make, what are the mechanisms? One, blood loss, so like hemorrhage, inadequate production of red blood cell, maybe due to oppression of the bone marrow, and excessive destruction of red blood cell, like in hemolysis, yes. Then what else? Then I want to quickly differentiate for you that you can see that the color index is 0.85 to 1.15, but mostly CROC likes to use 1 as the normal range of color index. That's why I'm telling you 1. But let's continue. So you should know the different size, yes? We have the normocytic, which is, this is the normal size, yes? As you can see, 7.2 to 8.0. Then you can see macrocytes, they are small, and macrocytes are big, and microcytes are mostly for iron deficiency anemia. A macrocyte or are found in megaloblastic anemia, mostly megaloblastic anemia. But you can also find megaloblastic and size cell in megaloblastic anemia too. Okay. So what is the difference between acute post-hemorrhagic anemia and acute and chronic post-hemorrhagic anemia? In acute, it's mostly due to extensive blood loss. And in chronic, it's mostly due to a chronic disorder. We're going to see as we continue, but let's move slowly. So you can see acute due to trauma and chronic due to lesion in the gastrointestinal tract. So maybe due to gastric ulcer and gynecological disturbances like uterine bleeding. Then hemolysis, we have the hereditary and acquired, which is classified under intrinsic, and we have the extrinsic. So don't let you cross focus on, I'll tell you as we move. So you should focus on this. Toxic hemolytic anemia. Of course, we'll talk about this. We'll talk about poisoning by hemolytic poison. So you can see the list of hemolytic poison. What should you focus on? Let's focus on what CROC is going to ask you. This, you should know this, okay? Membranopathy and enzymopathy. So membranopathy, you can see due to, there's a defect in the membrane of the red blood cell. And because there's a defect in the membrane of the red blood cell, this can cause hemolysis, because when they get into the reticular endothelial system, like your spleen, liver, and bone marrow, because I told you, how does your body know the normal size of red blood cells? Because this reticular endothelial system have sinusoid capillaries, and these sinusoid capillaries, the slit is just enough for the normal size of red blood cell. So when a red blood cell has spherocytes in shape or ellipsoid in shape or any of these, it's a defect in the membrane, and this will cause hemolysis. So macrophage will come and engulf this cell. You can see they also call it what, intracorpuscular. They can also say extravascular, because it's not occurring in the vessel, it's occurring in an organ, the destruction. And enzyme deficiency, you can see we've discussed about this in previous lectures, especially in biochemistry, pyruvate kinase deficiency and glucose phosphate deficiency. Then you also know that the microspheritocytosis is also called what, Minkowski-Schaffer disease. What is the characteristic sign? CROC will not talk about these signs only. Once they only talk about the name and the shape of the cell and the classification of membranopathy. Then, okay, let's get into the main issue, the ones you need to know for CROC. So alpha thalassemia, there's a decrease in erythrocyte hemoglobin color index. And you can see this unique form is known as what, target cells, also known as codocytes, okay? Then sickle cell anemia, there's a decrease in everything except what, the color index. The color index is nomochromic. CROC will not use the bilirubin level to ask you, okay? They'll focus on 1, 2, 3. You can see it's nomochromic, but in alpha thalassemia is decreased, yes. And what will you see in the smear? Of course, sickle cell. Okay, what else is Krupp going to talk about? Then as I think I can see, yes, acute post-hemorrhagic anemia due to rapid blood loss, like an accident. Yes, I can see wounding of vessel, mostly wounding of vessel. Yes, wounding of vessel. Please don't choose gastrointestinal bleeding, wounding of vessel. Because when there's like a stomach ulcer, uterine bleeding, you can see these are causes of post. Krupp will focus on what? Stomach ulcer and uterine bleeding. Then iron deficiency anemia. Iron deficiency anemia, you can see there's what? Decreased erythrocyte, reticulocyte, color index. But what do you see? Macrocytes, anemocyte, propiocytosis, basal cell. Please, you can see that iron deficiency is very similar to alpha thalassemia. Everything is decreased, but what's the difference? Alpha thalassemia, there's target erythrocytes. But in iron deficiency, you have microcytes, polyocytes, anemocytes, basal cells. You can see there's obvious target cell, but there's more target cell in alpha thalassemia. In clinical settings, it's very easy to differentiate these two, because when you give a patient with alpha thalassemia, because it presents very similar with iron deficiency, if you give this person iron, it wouldn't work. So you know you should test for alpha thalassemia. You must still find it in the Tunisia. Then iron deficiency anemia, there are other signs you can see. Maybe this person is on a strict diet, or when you give this person iron, the person recovers. Yes, so you know it's iron deficiency. So you can see the other signs. The another classic sign of iron deficiency is you can have glossitis, glossdenia, angular cheilitis, so on and so forth. You can see glossdenia. You can also see defective changes in nails like coleoptosis. Yes. Then iron refractory anemia. Iron refractory anemia is the same thing as it has similar clinical features such as iron deficiency, but the only difference is that there'll be increased level of what? Iron. When iron deficiency, there's decreased level of iron. Can you see it's also found in this protoporphyrin 9 deficiency? What did they say? Say it arises as a result of violation of iron, so inability for you to put iron into the hemoglobin. But there's iron, yes, you can't just put iron in the hemoglobin. So that's why it will have decreased, you can see. But what do you notice? Increased number of erythrocytes and increased cerebral disease is the key to differentiate. The megaloblastic anemia, there'll be macrocytes, megalocytes, and very important point is what? Can you see the color index increase? They even highlighted it in red. You can see that everything will decrease just because of an anemia, but color index will increase greater than one. In the smear, there'll be jelly bodies and cardboard rings. Then aplastic anemia means everything decreases. So the opposite of Van Kett's disease, right? So it's pancytopenia, okay? Because there's decrease of erythrocyte, leukocyte, and platelets, so everything decreased. But note that it is what? Normochromic. Okay, now that we are done with anemia, let's see the MCQ if we've covered all the topic. Yes. Okay, let's do this. So CLL, AML, and CLL. What are the key things you need to focus on when you approach this question? First of all, I'll show you the key things that is unique for all of them. For AL, it's mostly in children. CLL is, we'll talk about smudge cells, as you can see. We'll see the other name in Krupp. AML, mostly in adults. And chronic myelogenous leukemia, can you see the age 20 to 15? It's very rare in children. And what is the key sign in AML? Aroids, yes. And in CML, the key sign is tyrosine kinase. They can talk about Philadelphia chromosome, or what do you see? Increased eosinophil and basophil. Now, when you hear lymphocytic, I want you to think lymphocytes. And when you hear myelogenous, I want you to think neutrophil. In acute lymphocytic, when you hear acute, I want you to think blast cells. Yes, blast cells. For acute lymphocytic, think lymphoblast. In chronic lymphocytic, think lymphocytes. Then in chronic myelogenous leukemia, there would be an increase in meta. Okay, before I talk about this, let me show you a beautiful presentation. Please don't confuse it with regenerative left shift and degenerative left shift. They are totally different, right? Because this is leukemia. Our students like to mix it up. Okay, so in acute myeloid leukemia, yes, what do you see? There will be more of blast cells. You can see there's bone marrow failure. There's focus on bone marrow failure. There'll be anemia signs. What do you notice again? That there would be blood picture, anemia, thrombocytopenia, and you can see more of blast cell. Majority of leukocytes in the peripheral blood are blasts, yes, blastic cells. And sometimes it can be neutropenia sometimes. But when we get to MCQ, I'll show you how to differentiate. Then in CML, what you should focus on is, I want to show you, because there are three types. You can see the Philadelphia chromosome, yes. Then focus on this. The CML has three phases. So you can see in the blood smear, you're going to see what metamyelocyte, band form, myelocyte, promyelocyte, yes. Then this form, you have the chronic phase, accelerated phase, and blastic phase. So in the blastic phase, it's very close to acute myeloid leukemia. So it will start to resemble acute myeloid leukemia. The chronic phase is the most chronic stage, and that's where you see a lot of myelocyte and metamyelocyte and mature segmented neutrophil. Yes, so in this case, you're going to see more of what maybe the increase in mature segmented neutrophil. I'm telling you this because Kroc can put this mature segmented neutrophil is greater, and so that they can put that segmented neutrophil is less, because in the accelerated phase, as you can see, the blast counts will start to increase. So that will be start to drop the segmented. Yeah, why don't you think it's acute? In acute myelogenous leukemia, you won't see all those blasts, those cells I showed you. Okay, now that we know that, let's start. The sclera and skin of a 20-year-old patient becomes yellow periodically. He complains of asthenia. The illness was diagnosed as you can see, Schofield disease, and we know it's membranopathy, especially what microspheritocytosis. So what will you find in the blood test? Of course, spherocytosis. Anti-hemophilic globulin A, factor A. Anti-hemophilic globulin A, factor 8, was found absent in the plasma of a 3-year-old boy with pronounced hemorrhagic syndrome. So I think we explained in the first video, yes, the coagulation cascade, that's part 4, yes. And you know that factor 8 is in the intrinsic pathway, so that's why it will be intrinsic mechanism of prothrombinase activation. A 1.5-year-old child was hospitalized with symptoms of nitrate poisoning, persistent cyanosis, so on and so forth. So I told you that when I see this in pathophysiology, I was going to explain more. So we know from previous lecture that this is, of course, methemoglobin occurs when the Fe ferrous, when it changes from the ferrous to the ferric state, yes? So that's Fe2 to Fe3, yes? So the normal is Fe2 plus ferrous, but when it changes to ferric, Fe3 plus is pathologic. And what are the causes? So the congenital causes, yes, the congenital causes or primary causes, yes, congenital, like due to hemoglobin M or due to deficiency of NADPH. NADPH, please, just NADPH. Then in acquired is mostly due to what, as you can see, organic and inorganic nitrite and nitrates, and you can see the list of the rest, so please note it. So of course, they said poisoning with nitrates, cyanosis, dyspnea, formation of what hemoglobin caused this, of course, methemoglobin. A 3-year-old child was hospitalized with hemoglobinopathy, sickle cell anemia. What amino acid replaced glutamic acid in the beta chain of hemoglobin S? So we know that sickle cell anemia is the replacement of glutamic acid with valine on the beta chain, so E. A patient who arrived from Tunis or Tunisia refilled alpha thalassemia with hemolysis of erythrocytes. The presence of what cell in the blood are typical of this illness, of course, since it's alpha thalassemia, so what targets like cell or podocyte. A 36-year-old patient with respiratory viral infection was tested with sulfanilamide drug. Blood test findings revealed hypowatt regenerative normochrome, so it's normocytic, so color index is normal, but you see anemia, leukopenia, and thrombocytopenia, so of course it will be aplastic anemia. But of course, there's no aplastic anemia. They put what hypoplastic anemia, because it's first hypo, then aplastic anemia. Microcytemia, polycythemia, and anosmia are found in the patient blood smear. What anemias are these changes characteristic of? So you can see microcytes. I told you that microcytes is mostly in iron deficiency anemia and megalocytes in B12 or folic acid anemia deficiency. Anemia, yes, caused by decrease in vitamin B12 or folic acid. So of course, polycythemia, and this would be what? Iron deficiency. After resection of the stomach, the patient developed B12 deficiency anemia. What color index characteristic? So of course, it will be greater than 1, because in B12 deficiency anemia, there's increased color index, so greater than 1, so 1.4. A test finding of the peripheral blood of a 42-year-old patient are these. What do you see? Can you see you see a lot of blastic cell, promyelocytes? And what do you notice? You can see there's an increase in eosinophil and basophil because the normal rate of basophil is 0.1%. And the normal rate for eosinophil is what? 2 to 5%. So you can see it increase. Yes. So this is a characteristic sign of chronic myeloid leukemia. Yes. And you can see myeloblasts. In acute myeloid leukemia, they talk about aroids. They won't talk about all these myeloblastic cells. They won't talk about increase of basophil or eosinophil. So that's why I answer will be chronic myeloid leukemia, also known as myelosis. A woman complains of headache, dizziness, dyspnea during physical activity. For the last 3 years, she has been having extensive menstrual bleeding. What do you see? Extensive menstrual bleeding. So we're thinking of what? Chronic, what? Post-hemorrhagic anemia, because she's bleeding, it's hemorrhage. So I don't want you to think because the color index was low, it's iron deficiency. No, you also need to look at what caused it, yes. And they said due to heavy menstrual bleeding. So it's chronic post-hemorrhagic anemia. Because if you're using blood, of course, you should be losing iron. Yes, so that's why there was a sign of decreased color index. But it wasn't due to iron deficiency, it was due to the fact that she was bleeding. In the 6 months of pregnancy, a woman had the following blood findings. The amount of erythrocyte and hemoglobin is reduced. Color index is 1.4. Megalocytes, megaloblasts, and so on. So, of course, what type of anemia is this? B12 and folic acid deficiency. A 34-year-old woman is diagnosed with hereditary hemolytic anemia. They already put it here. What is the cause of hemolysis? So, we know it's microspherocytosis or what? Membranopathia. Blood examination reviewed leukocytosis, lymphocytosis, Botkin Grumfin shade. So this is also characteristic of what? It's also characteristic of this Botkin Grumpet shades are also not as much cells. So we know it's what chronic lymphoid leukosis. Blood examination reviewed thrombocytopenia as a complication of autoimmune process. What is the mechanism of thrombocytopenia onset? So, of course, they said due to autoimmune process, as a complication of autoimmune process. So, autoimmune is when your body attacks yourself, yes, your own body cells. So, it should be what? Increased destruction of thrombocytes. Why not increase consumption of thrombocytes? Because increased consumption of thrombocytes means that the thrombocytes are just being used up or consumed in the coagulation cascade. But here we have what? Destruction because of the autoimmune process. So, D. A 40-year-old man was diagnosed with sickle cell anemia. What is the mechanism of decreasing the erythrocyte? So it will be what? Intracellular hemolysis or intracorpuscular hemolysis, as you can see here in our presentation. Here. Let me show you again. So another option they can put is extravascular. So you can see that we have intracorpuscular what abnormalities here. So intracorpuscular. Then let's see if we find the extracorpuscular, yes? Let's see if there's extracorpuscular. So we can see it, yes? Extracorpuscular abnormalities, we can see it's mostly due to, you can have due to fetalis, due to a mismatch of blood. I thought I told you that extracorpuscular can also be called as intravascular because occurring in the vessels, yes, in the vessel itself. So examination is a restless incompatibility, mismatching of blood, and another cause can be due to malaria. Yes, malaria. This is mechanical trauma because I explained to you that malaria can lyse our red blood cell. Yes, we explained this in detail in the medical biology series, so you should know that. Okay. Let's continue, yes? So that's why the answer would be what? Intracellular hemolysis or what? This is also known as extravascular. Why intra? This is also known as what? Number A. A option known as extravascular. But intravascular hemolysis is also known as what? Extracorpuscular or extracellular. Okay, again, let's do it again. Intracellular is also known as extravascular, not in the vessel, extravascular. Then intravascular is also known as what? Extracellular hemolysis. It makes sense. You write that down, you see it makes sense. In a clinical observation of a 50-year-old man reviewed a decreased amount of erythrocytes in the blood and increased level of free hemoglobin in blood plasma. The color index is 0.85. what anemia this person most likely to have. So they can see there's a decrease of erythrocytes, but there's an increase in the free hemoglobin. So your erythrocyte decreased because it's being destroyed, and then hemoglobin is being released into the blood. That's why there's an increase. So we know it's a form of hemolysis. And out of our option, we can see is what's acquired hemolytic. In patients with chronic diffuse glomerular nephritis suffer from anemia. What is the pathogenesis of this anemia? So, of course, it will be diminished production of erythropoietin, because our kidney, you can see nephritis, our kidney makes erythropoietin, which stimulates erythropoiesis. Why are we not going to choose iron deficiency? Because you know, iron deficiency can also cause anemia, because they are seeing you that the patient had diffuse glomerular nephritis. So it's due to a kidney issue. Yes, not iron deficiency. That's what we're going for, E. Degenerative and regenerative form of erythrocyte are found. What still refers to regenerative? So I think I explained in the first lecture, yes, so reticulocytes. The erythrocyte of a patient with hypochronic anemia contains 45% hemoglobin S and hemoglobin A is 55%. What anemia is it? So the normal level of hemoglobin A should not be less than 95. And you can see it's 55. And hemoglobin A should be absent. And if it's 45, it's indicative of what? Sickle cell anemia. A 40-year-old woman who regularly uses aspirin developed hemorrhage. What caused this? Yes, disturbance. Okay, there was disturbance of functional activity of thrombocytes. What enzyme activity in thrombo is thrombopathy caused by? So the answer would be D, COX oxygenase. Why? Because look here, very important. NSAIDs, yes, this is pharmacology, non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs. Non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs. You can see that. Okay, let's start from here. You can see that COX-1 inhibitors, yes, any NSAID that inhibits COX-1, they can what? Because they can inhibit the production of PGE2, yes, which helps in gastric protection. And also, you can see here that thromboxane A2, they also wrote COX-1, yeah, it helps in what? Platelet aggregation and vasoconstriction. So you can see aspirin, and aspirin inhibits both COX-1 and COX-2. So that's why it presents with, it will affect the platelet aggregation. Yes, they can also replace that with gastric ulcer. Yes, and also aspirin, because aspirin inhibits COX-1, so it can also cause gastric ulcer. So that is why the answer, that's what caused the thrombocyte pathy. Yes, that's what caused the hemorrhage, was decreased thrombocytes. Yes, there was decreased platelet aggregation. So the answer would be D. A 58-year-old woman complains of fatigue, sleepiness, deep sleep when walking fast. The analysis of the blood reveals the following. The erythrocyte is quite normal, but what do you observe? That the color index is very low. I mean, out of the option that it's iron deficiency, the color index is low. Why are we not going for thalassemia? Because I told you, if thalassemia, it talked us about thalassemia. They either talk about Tunisia or they talk about target cells or codocyte. But once they say color index is low and they didn't specify anything to be iron deficiency, in sickle cell anemia, the color index is normal. Iron deficiency anemia is diagnosed, and in pernicious anemia, the color index is greater than 1. Iron deficiency anemia is diagnosed. Atrophic and dystrophic changes in the alimentary canal. So you can see glossitis, gingivitis. So we're thinking of iron deficiency anemia, yes. What caused this? Of course, decreased activity of iron-containing enzymes. So that's the end of the lecture. In the next lecture, we're going to talk about ECG, how to read ECG. We're also going to talk about heart failure. We're going to talk about left and right heart failure. We're going to talk about hypertrophy of the heart, the compensatory mechanism. We're also going to talk about heart failure by overload and heart failure by resistance. Thank you very much. If I explained something that was difficult before, you can show your appreciation by subscribing, commenting anything. I'll be so grateful, and liking this video. Don't forget to share to your friends. Thank you very much, and I wish you good luck in your crop preparation.